choir. What a blessing today to be able to worship God. The baptism service today, but knowing we rejoice and give praise to God. Be able to gather here today, the Lord's Supper, to remember Jesus. Remember His love and His sacrifice for us. In our text this morning, the writer from Hebrews speaks of the new covenant, and he quotes Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34 in this text, in Hebrews the 8th chapter, beginning with verse 6. Hebrews 8, beginning with verse 6, going through verse 15. Verse 13. Hebrews 8, chapter, beginning with verse 6. But the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one, and that is found on better promises. For if there had been nothing wrong with that first covenant, no place would have been sought for another. But God found fault with the people and said, "The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. Because they did not remain faithful to my covenant, I turned away from them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel. And after that time, declares the Lord, I will put my laws in their minds. I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbor, or a man his brother saying, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete, and what is obsolete and aging will soon disappear." The writer of Hebrews quotes Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. And Jeremiah proclaimed that there would be a new covenant one day. And this new covenant would be written on the hearts of people. That there would be fellowship with God. And that this new covenant would be for all people. And God would give a full and final pardon. The theme of Hebrews is the superiority of Christ. That Jesus Christ is God. That He is superior to the priest. And that He ministers on the basis of a better covenant. The writer of Hebrews presents evidence for this superior covenant. You see, the readers of the letter of Hebrews, they were going through a difficult time. Many of the Jewish people were being tempted to go back to the old Jewish religion. And how easy it would be for the Jewish believers to escape the punishment they were going through by the Jews. They were looked down upon for being followers of Christ by many. And the writer wanted them to just take the time to evaluate, to look at what they had in Jesus. And it's imperative that you and I, that we take the time as well to look at what we have in Jesus. Jesus is better than anything they had under the law. Jesus is better than anything that we would be tempted to put before our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we surrender our hearts and our lives to Him, He gives us abundant life, everlasting life, and peace. The new covenant has a superior high priest. Jesus was perfect in every way. Jesus alone is perfect. The Old Testament priests were sinners, but God Himself has come in Jesus. The new covenant is found on superior promises. Moses was the mediator of the old covenant and the giving of the law. The mediator of the new covenant is Jesus. Jesus is God. Before our Lord went to Calvary, He celebrated the Passover with His disciples in the upper room. And there He instituted the Lord's Supper. And He said, "This cup is the New Testament covenant in My blood, which is shed for you." He established the new covenant with His blood that was shed for us. You see, both covenants were given by God. Both covenants were given for the people's good. Both covenants had God's blessings attached to them. But the new covenant through Jesus has God's promise of God's grace. The new covenant depends on God's faithfulness to His promise to man. God had led Israel out of Egypt. The nation had failed. They continued, the scripture says in Hebrews 8:7, "not in My covenant," as He quotes from the Old Testament. God disciplined them. He put them into captivity. The friends, God found no fault with His covenant, but it was with His people. The problem is not with God's law, but the problem is with our sinful nature, with sinful people. No one can become a part of God's new covenant without faith in Christ. It is through Jesus alone, through Him, that we come to God. And the new covenant grace says, the work has been done on Calvary. It's been done in Jesus. And our part is to believe in Jesus, and we receive eternal life. The new covenant, the work has been done. Jesus has done the work for us on the cross. And our part is to believe and to receive the gift of God of salvation, of a personal love relationship with Him now and throughout all of eternity. The new covenant has the promise also of an internal change. The law could declare God's standard, and it does, and it still does today. But it could not provide the power needed for obedience. When we trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, when we surrender our lives unto Him, we receive the Holy Spirit. God takes up residence within our lives, within our hearts. The moment that we receive Jesus, that we trust in Him as our Lord and as our Savior, the Holy Spirit is within us. And the Holy Spirit is there to empower us to be a witness for Him, to empower us to live for Him. And as God's children, we must continually make the conscious choice to obey God, to cooperate with Him, with His Holy Spirit. And as we yield unto God, God will lead us into righteousness. God will lead us into an abundant life.
God will bless our lives as we yield our lives unto Him. Friends, we have to remember in this life who is for us and who's against us. God is for us. Jesus called Satan a liar and the father of all lies. He is against you. He is against me. But if we will listen to God, if we'll invite Him in as Lord to take control, and as we yield ourselves to God, we are blessed by God, and God uses us to be a blessing to others. It is by yielding to the Holy Spirit that we fulfill the righteousness of the law. The new covenant gives us forgiveness for all who call upon the name of Jesus. In Jeremiah 31, verse 44, it is also quoted in verse 12 in our text, we find these words, "For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more." Look at the promise. Look at the blessing. I will forgive their. God will forgive your, my wickedness. And He'll remember our sins no more. For those who trust in Jesus are forgiven. Praise God for His grace, for His forgiveness. The new covenant brings eternal life and eternal blessings. Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. The new covenant will never disappear. It will never disappoint you. Our Lord ministers to us on the basis of His blood shed for us. We are new creatures in Christ. And the writer of Hebrews, he wanted the Jewish believers. He simply wanted them just to look. Look at what you have in Jesus. Look at what Jesus has sacrificed, what He's done for you, what He has given to you. And that Jesus is God. He is the superior high priest. And I challenge us today to look at what we have in Jesus. It's important for us as we gather today to remember Jesus Christ as we observe the Lord's Supper, to remember what God has done for us in Jesus. In the Old Testament and the New Testament, it calls us to remember. Then it calls us to repent of our sins and to turn to God. Friends, it's also important that you and I, that we remember and give thanks for what God has done for us in the past in Jesus, but for how that He has personally helped you and me in the past. When God has come through for us, when we've turned to Him in prayer and called others to pray with us, of how that God has answered prayer. God has helped us at our deepest hour of need. May He, oftentimes He does not remove the circumstances from us, but He ministers to us. And it's imperative for you and I to remember what we have in Jesus, to remember what Jesus has done for us in the past, and give thanks for what He's going to do for us today and the future, and one day we'll be in heaven with Him. For us to keep our focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, to keep our focus on the eternal things, the things that matter. Yet Satan tempts us to put selfish and petty things before the Lord Jesus Christ. And friends, you and I will never be blessed by God when we put something before Jesus. He deserves first place within our lives. And as we willingly and freely give Him first place, He will bless us. And He'll use us to be a blessing to others. Friends, I challenge you. I encourage you, as I do myself, let us remember what we have in Jesus. Let us remember what He's already done for us. And let us willingly, eagerly yield ourselves unto Him, surrender our life on a daily basis to include Him in all of life. We come under His lordship, His leadership upon our life. As we sing our hymn of invitation this morning, as the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart, I pray that we'll all be obedient unto Him. If He's calling you here today for salvation, won't you surrender your life to Jesus and trust in Him for salvation? If you're here and already a child of God, and God is speaking to you, be obedient to what He's calling you. If you believe that God is calling you to unite and serve here at Antioch, won't you come as we sing our hymn of invitation?